You know, I've introduced to a lot of authors. I don't think I've ever been so conscious of how I'm standing. Thank you for joining us. We're Reporters for Books, and as always, thank you for supporting your local independent or one of your local independent bookstores. A couple of logistics. At the end of the talk tonight, number one, we'll have some entertainment that Amy will tell you about, but also we have copies of Amy's new book and two of Simon's books that if you need additional copies of presents, which you do, or if you'd like Simon's books, we'll be selling them at the table over there, and they'll be sitting and signing over here. So tonight we have a real Ted-a-palooza. We were not able to get Ken Robinson, but we do have the people whose TED Talks are the second and third most watched TED Talks in all of TED, clocking in at a combined total of about 55 million views. For those of you keeping score at home, is close to the population of Italy. Now, granted, a number of those views were me, and probably the people in this room responsible for a few more, but even if you take all of us out, that's still a hell of a lot of people. And our third guest did something quite miraculous in a TED Talk as well, so let me tell you about her first. Adrianne Haslet-Davis was watching the Boston Marathon with her husband when the bombs went off near where they were standing. They were both injured, and Adrianne lost part of her left leg. She was a professional dancer, and her injury could, in addition to the horrible emotional toll it took, have ended her career as well. But she met a man named Hugh Hare, who is the director of biomechatronics research at MIT at the Media Lab, and he designed a bionic limb for her that was programmed to recognize and anticipate the dynamics of the movements that the dancer made. Less than a year after the bombing, at the end of a TED Talk that Hare was giving, she appeared and danced for the first time in public. She's also the subject of a documentary by Anderson Cooper, who met her in her hospital room shortly after the attack. Simon Sinek grew up in England, South Africa, and Hong Kong before ending up in New Jersey. Presumably he was not satisfied with the way those other people spoke English. He came to this area to go to Brandeis, located nearby in the suburb of Cambridge, and eventually ended up working in the advertising business in a couple of very large agencies, and then his own, which he started in 2002. He gave his super-duper TED Talk in September 2009, and his book, Start With Why, How Great Leaders Inspire Everyone to Take Action, which is one of the two titles we have over there for you of his, was released a month later and became a bestseller for corporate America. He's involved in a number of nonprofits, and now lives in New York, where, among other things, he teaches a graduate course in strategic communications. Amy Cuddy was also a dancer. Now, you may not know this, but she was also a roller skating waitress at a famous diner, which is, of course, a historical way that great ballet dancers have paid the bills when they couldn't get work being ballet dancers. And she was in a terrible car accident during college and suffered a serious brain injury she had to rebuild herself, both physically and mentally. She was able to go back to school and graduate, and then came to Massachusetts, and then on to Princeton, a very fine institution, much beloved by me, though not in a suburb of Cambridge, Massachusetts, where she got her doctorate in social psychology. Let me also add that along the line, she spent several seasons following the Grateful Dead. She ended up at Harvard Business School in 2008, where she's been ever since, and where she teaches about negotiation and power and influence. She did some very interesting work on the relationship between competence and warmth, and then began studying the nonverbal cues that eventually led to the research behind her blockbuster TED Talk in 2012 about posture and poses. And I believe I'm standing up straight now. That talk was what she expanded into this book, which came out last month, and about which I have nothing more to say other than to ask you to join me in welcoming our guests tonight.
First, my guests who traveled to be here, and a special musical surprise treat for you at the end of the night. I'll introduce those from later. I want to thank my lab manager, Jack Schultz, who's sitting here in front filming, who, you know, I sent them to make a sort of handwritten co-author on the book, because he's done an enormous amount of work to make all these things come together. So can we thank him first? And we have another friend filming too, Reed, standing over here. So thank you. We've got two people filming. I also want to thank briefly, because it could get long, my husband Paul, who moved from Australia to be with me a couple of years ago after we met through friends online, and now he's here. And the moment when we really fell in love, I think that was first I quoted Leonard Cohen, and he said, I've got that book on my shelf right here in Australia. And I think that the quote was, there is a crack in everything, that's how the light gets in. And then the moment for me, at least, was when things started to get exciting in my life, a kind of scary way, when people started to get interested in the work I was doing. And he was choked up and said, there's nothing more wonderful than to see the world embrace the person you love for the very reasons that you love. So, thank you. Because writing a book is not a fun thing to be around, you know, if you're not the person writing. It's actually not that fun when you're the person writing either. And in the same vein, I want to thank my son Jonah, who's sitting in the front row, bowing down. Hi. I'm a mom. Really, the most present person I've ever met in my life. I don't really understand it. You know, from the time we could speak, people were referring to him as a wise old soul. He has a wisdom that I just don't really understand, and I can take no credit for. But he certainly inspires me every day, and I feel. As much as I'd like to say, you know, I parented him and raised this great kid, I feel more like I got really lucky in the roommate lottery. And like he's this really amazing person who lives with me, who I learn a lot from. And he also has been incredibly patient, so John, thank you. And I'm not willing to make eye contact with him. And there are many others, but I'll stop there. I want to just do a little bit of a reading before I start talking. I'm more of a talker than a reader. So I think you will probably find it more interesting if I chat with these amazing, lovely, and smart guests that I have. But I do want to give you a little bit of background for those of you who haven't read the book, and I'm assuming most of you have not read the book yet, but about sort of what led me to get interested in this topic. And I think there were a lot of things when the researchers look back and all of a sudden all the different lines become clear, but they're not clear as you're getting there. And I certainly now see how impactful having this serious head injury was on my interest in power and presence. And you know, having been a professional ballet dancer, certainly it's not a surprise that I'm interested in the body-mind connection. But I want to read a little bit about the head injury, which I referred to in my TED Talk for those of you who have seen it. But I want to say a little bit more about it, because I think that head injury, for anyone who has either experienced it or is close to someone who has, you'll know that it's different from other injuries, because people don't understand. They can't see it in the same way, and you're different in a way that is very noticeable to you, maybe noticeable to others, but not in ways that people can articulate. And it really leads to a sense of personal powerlessness. So I was in this accident. We were driving from from Montana to Colorado overnight, and we were in Wyoming, and it was the middle of the night, and my friend fell asleep, and it was a single car accident, and I was thrown out of the car. So I sustained a traumatic brain injury. More specifically, I suffered a diffuse axonal injury, which is called a DAI. In a DAI, the brain is subjected to shearing forces, usually from severe rotational acceleration, which is quite common in car accidents. Imagine what happens during a high-speed car crash. With the sudden and extreme change in velocity upon impact, your body abruptly stops, but your brain continues to move, and sometimes even rotate within the skull, which it is not meant to do, and even bangs back and forth against your skull, which it is also not meant to do. The force of my head slamming into the highway, which fractured my skull, probably didn't help matters. The brain is meant to exist in a safe space, protected by the skull and cushioned by several thin membranes called meninges and cerebrospinal fluid. The skull is the brain's friend, but the two are never intended to touch. The shearing forces of a severe head injury tear and stretch neurons and their fibers called axons throughout the brain. Like electrical wires, axons are insulated by a protective coating or buffer called the myelin sheath. Even if an axon isn't severed, damage to the myelin sheath can significantly slow the speed at which information travels from neuron to neuron. So, in a DAI, the injury occurs throughout the brain. Unlike a focal brain injury, such as a gunshot wound, where damage strikes a very specific location, everything the brain does depends on neurons communicating. When neurons throughout the brain are damaged, their communication is inevitably damaged as well. So when you have a DAI, no doctor is going to tell you, well, the damage is to your motor area, so you're going to have trouble with movement. Or it's to your speech area, so you're going to have difficulty producing and processing speech. They won't know if you'll recover, how well you'll recover, or which brain functions will be affected. Will your memory be impaired, your emotions, your spatial reasoning, your small motor skills? Given how little we understand about DAIs, the likelihood that a doctor can offer an accurate prognosis is dismal. After a DAI, you are a different person in many ways. How you think, how you feel, how you express yourself, respond, interact, all of these dimensions are affected. On top of that, your ability to understand yourself has probably taken a hit. So you're not really in a position to know exactly how you've changed. And no one can tell you what to expect. So, although our way of thinking, our intellect, our affect, our personality, these aren't things we expect will ever change. We take them for granted. For many years after the head injury, I was trying to pass as my former self. Although I didn't really know who that former self was, I felt like an imposter in my own body. I had to relearn how to learn. I kept trying to start school again because I couldn't accept people telling me that I couldn't do it. I had to study circles around others, and slowly, eventually, and to my unspeakable relief, my mental clarity began to return. I finished college 4 years after my pre-accident classmates. And one of the reasons I persisted was that I found something I liked to study, psychology. After college, I managed to enter a profession that required a fully functioning brain. And as Anatole France wrote, all changes have their melancholy, for what we leave behind is a part of ourselves. We must die to one life before we can enter another. Along the way, not surprisingly, I became a person for whom all these questions of presence and power, of confidence and doubt, took on a great deal of significance. My injury led me to study the science of presence, but it was my TED talk that made me realize how universal the yearning for it is. Because here's the thing, most people are dealing with stressful challenges every day. People in every corner of the world and in all walks of life are trying to work up the nerve to speak in class, to interview for a job, to audition for a role, to confront a daily hardship, to stand up for what they believe in, or just to find peace being who they are. This is true of people who are homeless and people who are, by traditional standards, wildly successful. Fortune 500 executives, winning trial lawyers, gifted artists and performers, victims of bullying and prejudice and sexual assault, political refugees, people dealing with mental illness, or who have suffered grave injuries, all of them face these challenges. And so do all the people working to help those people. The parents, spouses, children, counselors, doctors, colleagues, and friends of those who are struggling. All these people, the vast majority of whom are not scientists, have forced me to look at my own research in a new way. They simultaneously take me away from the science and bring me closer to it. Hearing their stories, I became obliged to think about how social science findings actually play out in the real world. I started to care about doing research that changes lives in a positive way, but I also started coming up with basic questions that may never have occurred to me if I had stayed inside the lab and steeped myself in the literature. So I'm going to pause there. I'd like to bring up Simon. And that I learned through studying presence, which I think of as the ability to be attuned to and able to really express your true feelings and beliefs and talents and abilities and values, is that when you are able to do that and bring that forth in stressful interactions, and by the way, stressful interactions usually involve an element of social judgment and the fear of being kicked out of a plan, when you can do that, you liberate others to do the same thing. So when you can be authentic, you signal to others that you're trustworthy. You're being real with them, and they can be real with you. When Simon and I met, we met on a flight, actually, on the way to a couple of years ago, and we sat next to each other, and we'd never met, but I'm sure we'd seen each other's TED Talks. That's it.
Yeah, I mean, it was we were both flying to Ted, it was a total coincidence. I got on a plane.
It was like in Minneapolis or something.
Yeah, I think I was catching a connection. You were already on the aircraft. And I went to my seat, and he was sitting next to me, but Amy Cuddy. And I was like, cool. yeah, that is how we met.
And we started talking. Actually, I think a guy in front of us turned around and was like, cool, and took a picture of us. Here's what happened. Before we even took off, we had made a plan to write a case study and called the case protagonist and had already arranged a trip to go visit three of his factories in Wisconsin. So basically, in 5 minutes, we realized that we were completely on the same page about how people connect with each other, how presence begets presence, how personal power is so important in building organizations that support people, that bring out the best in people, and we had already made a plan within 5 minutes. So that's
I'm going to share. I'm going to share another story from that flight.
Okay.
Which is, this is from in flight, so more than 5 minutes. And in the middle of the flight, we hit some turbulence, and Amy went like this, and I looked over and said, "Shouldn't you be sitting like this?" As it turns out, it actually works in turbulence as well.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about personal power and not being like all the time, and allowing the people who work with you and for you to speak before you speak.
Though we came in very different paths, I think the single biggest lesson I learned that profoundly changed my trajectory and set me on this path as well, the one that I'm on, came from pain also. But the lesson was that I don't have to know all the answers, and I don't have to pretend that I do, because that was my life before, thinking that I had to know all the answers, because I would, you know, and if I didn't, I would pretend that I did, because I thought that that was where my credibility came from.
Can you turn the volume up or speak?
I can, yeah, how's that? Is that better?
That's better.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shall I start again? So I believe that my power, or my presence came from my intelligence or my authority or any of these things. So I believed I had to know all the answers, and if I didn't, I had to pretend that I did. And that was profoundly wrong, because trying to do that, my life was more difficult. And it was only when I had the courage to ask for help, admit I didn't know, amazingly people are there to help when you ask. And that is what really changed my trajectory, which is when I started asking for help and relying on the help of others. That's when I think I learned presence, and that's when I think I learned trajectory. Probably because of traditional definitions of the word power.
Which are?
Force,
right.
Aggression.
Yeah. Dominance.
So I it's not a comfortable word. So.
Yeah.
It's knowing your work, it's not comfortable.
So it has a lot of language, and it's funny, I teach at the business school, and I do say, it doesn't have that much baggage there. And for me, it had a lot of baggage. But that's when I started to really understand the difference between social power, which is power over. So it's power over others, it's power over resources and access to resources. Personal power is power over access to the resources that you possess within yourself. And I know that sounds a little hokey, and it kind of makes me sad that it does, right? That word sort of empowerment got taken away. But that really is what it is. So it's the ability for you to access what you already have inside you. And I want to just briefly tell a story that I think speaks to this. So I was at a bookstore cafe in Boston, and I was working on my book, and often people will come up and say, I saw your TED Talk and it changed my life, and this is what happened to me. And honestly, every story to me feels like the first time I'm hearing a story like this, and I cry usually every time. And this woman said, I lived in Texas, and she was from Iran, and she felt like an outsider, and there were a lot of things that made her feel like an imposter. Very smart, went to the University of Texas, and wanted to go to medical school, but was too afraid to take the MCAT exam. And so she ended up moving to Boston, which felt more comfortable to her, and becoming a waitress. And she said, I saw your talk, and I thought, I'm taking the MCAT. I'm going to fake it. And what she meant by that was not, I'm going to fake having knowledge that I don't have. It was, I'm going to fake having the confidence to take that test. I have the knowledge. And so she took the MCAT, and she nailed it. And she got into a lot of medical schools. And I love that story because she didn't fake having that knowledge. She couldn't fake having knowledge of stem cells or whatever you had to take on the MCAT. She knew those things. She just had to unlock it, and that is personal power. And when we can do that, we're able to share ourselves with other people and to not feel threatened by them. We don't feel defensive because we know who we are, we know what we know, and we're just able to be there with them. And I think that's what allows you to be present. It allows you to be in the moment when you're not afraid. You can't access that best part of yourself, that authentic part of yourself. Let's sit down. And I'd like to read another part of the book that will lead us into another discussion of how presence kind of begets presence and the importance of listening. And this part of the book is about a person who's become another good friend of mine, Jeffrey Brown, who's a Baptist minister in Boston, who was part of what's known as the Boston Miracle in the early 90s, where he and a few of his young colleagues walked the streets of Boston in the wee hours of the night from 10 p.m. to 2 a.m., getting to know the gang members in a time when gang violence had really peaked. Some of you probably remember that time. It was pretty awful. And Jeffrey had to do a lot of things to get himself to a place where he could go do that. And the first was that
Jeffrey would say, and see a lot of people can't, you know, I think we have to stand up because I see that people can't see us. But Jeffrey would say that he wanted to have a mega church. So Jeffrey was a young Black Baptist minister. He was about 26, and he never thought that he would be working on the streets. He thought that he would be moving out to the suburbs and having a big mega church, and as he even jokes around, having a clothing line. And he one night lost a few meters from the steps of his church, which was in Cambridge. A young man was stabbed to death in a gang incident. And that young man's family, his name was Jesse, asked him to lead a vigil. And he didn't really want to do it, and he did it. And he went out there and felt really uncomfortable. He thought, these aren't the people coming to that church. I don't really know what to say to them. But he felt that this was what he had to be doing. And I want to read a little bit about how he handled himself. He said Jesse's murder marked a turning point for Jeffrey. He saw the inherent flaw, the paradox, of his approach to the problem. You had these gang youth who I was treating as the other, he says, and I was trying to build community, but I wasn't giving them any gateway into my definition of community. So I said, if you're going to build a community, you have to build community with everybody, which means the folks, the other people, don't want in the community. Which means these kids. Jeffrey showed up at Eugene's house. This was his friend, who also walked the streets with him, Eugene Rivers. Jeffrey showed up at Eugene's house that Friday night after the clerics meeting because he knew that the head of the street committee was right. It was time to seek a solution out there. So we walked, Jeffrey recalled. We walked from 10 at night until 2 in the morning, and it was always popping. On the second Friday, fewer than half of the original 13 clergy members returned. Soon, the number dropped to 4. Jeffrey, Eugene, 2 others. But they were committed. I knew that walking the streets and talking to the kids was the key to something, Jeffrey said, but I didn't know what. That was about being present. Knowing this is something that I'm supposed to be doing, and I don't have the answers. And I'm going to go out there and be open to these people who do have the answers without judgment. And it was not about being fearless. He had enormous fear. It was about being brave. It was about pushing through that fear and going out there and doing it anyway. And after a year of doing this, he gained the trust of these kids. And they explained to him what was going on. They didn't want to be out there. Why would they want to be out there? They weren't, you know, dangerous predators. They were young people who didn't know what they should be doing and wanted a community. And here they were having an opportunity to actually be heard and seen for the first time. One of the things that I love so much about Jeffrey is that even though he did all this work and reduced gang violence dramatically, and you can read a lot of academic reports and analyses of what led to this reduction in gang violence, and you can see that this was the main contributing factor. He still said he didn't have all the answers. And even, you know, a decade later, he didn't have all the answers. He said one night he had to go to the hospital because a young man he had been working with to negotiate a truce, a young gang member, was shot and killed. And the police, at that point, after getting to know these young ministers, they called these guys before they called them. They called them to come to the emergency room, to come and talk to the family when the family arrived. So he got there and to identify the body, and to talk to this young man, James's parents. And he said he's in this, you know, in this anguished and chaotic hospital waiting room. Jeffrey learned an important lesson. In some situations, there's no such thing as winning. There was nothing anyone could have said or done to ease the suffering and calm the anger of those James left behind. Jeffrey struggled, but was left with these thoughts. I have no answers. There are no words. To think in every case that you will be able to summon a magic phrase or an impressively bold deed is simply self-aggrandizing. At moments like these, just being there and listening may be enough. in the long run, it may be better than anything else. People have called that a ministry of presence, Jeffrey said, and I find that it's among the most effective ways to do ministry, you know, to shut up and just be there. Sometimes we express ourselves most eloquently by not expressing anything, by allowing our presence, unexplained and unembellished, to speak for itself. Chat with someone a bit more about this idea.
So we were just chatting before we started about this idea of fearlessness versus bravery. I have the great honor of getting to work with and have gotten to know many men and women in our armed forces, and have been around a lot of people who have risked their lives for others. They are not fearless, but they are brave. The thing that I've become interested in your thought is, when talking about courage, people think courage is this sort of intestinal fortitude, which I don't believe it is. You know, that when necessary, you have to dig down deep and find the courage, which I think is nonsense. I think courage is an external thing. That when you have someone in your life who says, I believe in you, I've got your back, don't worry, it'll be okay, that only when you have that intense love and care from someone around you does that give you the courage to act. And if you see someone who has that force in their life, that person in their life, who then acts with courage, it inspires other people to then follow and act with courage. In other words, it's a social thing, not this deep internal thing. I'm interested in your thoughts of bravery and courage as a social construct, not just an individual thing.
I think that Jeffrey, since he explains, and I write about this, that the way that what led to them going out on the streets was that they were meeting with 300 other clergy every Tuesday night to talk about how to deal with this problem, and bringing in experts and all these outsiders. And then it was Eugene Rivers who stood up and said, you know, the one party that we haven't brought in is the actual gang members themselves. And people laughed at him and said, okay, Eugene, you can start the street committee. And that's how that started. And then Jeffrey showed up at his house thinking, I guess we'll go to his house and talk about the street committee. But he got there and Eugene said, all right, let's go out there. We're going to go walk the streets. So although I do see Jeffrey as the model as the sort of inspiration for others to have that kind of courage, someone did that for him as well. But I think that that's half of it. And as a social psychologist, I think the pressure of the social situation is huge. So I think that others can change people in a positive way enormously. But I also think that for Jeffrey, part of the process was, and I think it's true for these people, and we talked about this, I think, a lot before, is saying, and I remember one concert in particular where somebody sort of thought she had failed, and this was a military officer who thought she had failed her people, and decided, or thought she had failed at her ambitions, and decided to give up on her ambitions and instead just make the most of it for these people she was tending to.
DDF, Lieutenant
Colonel DDF. And so she thought, well, I'm going to get kicked out. I'm done. My military career is over. I failed. So I'm going to care for these other people now.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, 6 months later, she was doing phenomenally well because these people she had cared for, she said, I'm going to bring out the best in them. I'm going to make them brave. I'm going to show them. I'm going to hold up a mirror to them. And so it was when she was able to stop focusing on the future ambition and be in the present that she could help them be present and be their best. So I think that the interesting thing there was that it was her self-reflection that's sort of saying, well, I'm not going to get this concrete sort of distant goal that I had is not going to happen. But I know who I am, and I guess I'm a good person, and I care about people, so that's what I'm going to do now. So I think it's when we affirm those core values in ourselves and become really clear about who we are that we walk into these stressful situations, these challenges, without so much fear, because we know that no matter what happens, even if we fail in that audition or job interview or whatever it is, we're still who we are when we leave. That concrete outcome doesn't matter. And to take a sort of lighter example, one of the many people who wrote to me was a young guy named Will Cuddy, who's not related to me, now in service, but Will wrote to me and said, I'm a young actor who's a college student at Oregon State University, and he said, I had this opportunity to audition for this big role, a role in a big movie. And he said, I was not, fit to do this. And my agent said, no, I don't think you should do it anyway. And he said, he went to the audition, and he was in the waiting room, and he looked around, all these guys, he said, were just way more professional than he was. And so it was set in Oregon. It was supposed to be an outdoorsy young guy. He looks around and thinks there's no way, and he gets up to leave. And instead, he said his cousin had told him, his friend had told him about this talk he had seen where you're supposed to stand in a powerful posture that will make you feel better. And he said, I had no idea what exactly he was supposed to do, but I remembered this advice. So I went to the bathroom. For 2 minutes, I stood like Wonder Woman. And I came back out, and I felt much better. And I really just felt like myself. And so I went through this audition, and it went incredibly well, and I loved it, and I enjoyed every minute of it. And I left the audition, and his dad was waiting for him. He was so sweet. His dad was there. And his dad said, how'd it go? And he goes, I nailed it. And he said, you got the part? And he said, I don't know. But I nailed it. It felt great. So he had forgotten the concrete outcome. He loved it so much that he forgot the concrete outcome. He did get the part. And the part was in the movie Wild with Reese Witherspoon. And he's one of the young guys she meets at the end. And actually, he and his dad flew out and went to the premiere with Paul and Jonah and me here in Boston, actually in Cambridge, Kendall Square. And so, it was forgetting about that concrete outcome that allowed him to bring his head to really be present in that moment. It's when he said, I'm not going to get this role. I'm just going to do this thing that I enjoy. And I think it's a similar kind of thing that happens there. So I think that you do have to have models and people who believe in you and say, you can do this. And also, I think you can tell yourself that. But not in the Stuart Smalley, I'm good enough, I'm smart enough, and don't let people like me way. You have to do it by knowing who you are. It's not that you're going to be great at everything. It's not that you're not going to be a great public speaker if you're not a great public speaker. But you know who you are. And you can go in and do this thing and come out still knowing who you are. I want to talk a little bit more about some of the people that you and I have met and the work that we've been doing and the power of being present and shutting up and listening. And I want to be thinking about this particular conversation that we had. So Simon and I have been trying to develop this case on an interesting company called Barry Miller that uses a really unusual approach. It's a very macho kind of company in some ways. They make machines that make machines. Like the guys that work for this company and these plants are like local, corn-fed, homegrown guys who went to high school there and their parents worked there, and they're not used to being touchy-feely. But the guy that runs the company, Bob Chapman, really believes that people need to learn to communicate. So he asks them to go through this communication seminar, and they really learn how to be good to each other. It's kind of amazing. He gives them an enormous amount of freedom to take care of each other because he really feels that people want to care for each other, that you have to liberate people to care for each other, that we are decent, and you have to allow people to be decent. And so one of the things that happened when we were visiting and trying to take notes in Riker's case, we were visiting a plant in this tiny town in northern Wisconsin with like 800 people, and half the town worked at this plant. And Simon said, well, how do you guys self-police? Like, what if people do something wrong? And they didn't know what it was. We were sitting at a table with, administrative staff, people who worked at the plant. I mean, these are people who are not making a whole lot of money. They love this company that they work for. They're not used to business, MBA talk. And yeah, he said something about self-policing. And I mean, do you remember how long it took for people to figure out what the question was?
Yeah, they didn't understand the question.
And then what happened? Do you remember?
No,
what happened? So finally, the woman said, they struggled for so long, and he kept trying to rephrase this question. And finally, this woman said, oh, you mean, when somebody does something that's not consistent with who they are, and He's like, okay, maybe. And she says, I know, I have a story. There was a guy who was stealing stuff from the office, like a lot of stuff. And we realized that something was obviously going wrong in his life. Like, this is not the person who he wants to be. So we called him in and talked to him and asked him, what can we do to help him? That's what it was. What can we do to help him? And it turned out, you know, he was struggling. All these things were happening. He brought all his stuff back and was so apologetic, and he still works here. But the whole idea of self-policing didn't make any sense to them. It was, oh, well, somebody's doing something bad. Something is going wrong in their lives, and we need to help them get through that.
One of the amazing things about this company, as they learn presence through the leadership philosophies of Bob, is they become intended byproducts is empathy. It just sort of shows up all over the place. They're not trained to do it. They're not told to do it. It's not like, you know, in so many other organizations where they write integrity on the wall. That's all they do.
They don't even get what it means.
No, right.
They're just taught to listen to each other.
But at this place, it's kind of a magical place to visit. You don't realize companies like this exist. And it's just good old-fashioned American manufacturing. There's nothing beautiful about it. I mean, it's not high-tech at all. And it's just amazing to me that people who care for each other because they've gone through this process of learning to be comfortable with who they are and not feeling like they have to compete against each other, but rather to put themselves out.
Right. So instead of, you know, there was an older guy that we talked to who'd been working on a machine for 20 years, and there used to be this tension between the young guys and the old guys, where the old guys felt like, I don't want to teach the young guys who are going to take my job at a lower wage. Like, I don't want to teach them how to work this machine. And then Bob gave them the opportunity to develop manuals about these machines. Like, how do you fix this machine? And so basically they were allowed to share all of their knowledge and their skill and everything that they had learned over these years with these younger guys. So instead of the younger guys coming and saying, I don't have your time to do this, they developed these manuals that were really an expression of who they were. And they took an enormous amount of pride in it. And you know, everybody we talked to was at these three plants got choked up when they talked to them about the ability to be present and how it allowed them to be more empathic and compassionate. And it's pretty amazing.
Can you talk more about, because we saw it happen, but can you talk more about the connection between presence and trust?
Yeah, so I think that when you are present, and again, this idea, let me just back up a minute and say, one of the goals of this book for me was to take presence off of its pedestal. It's not an idea, they're a concept that's not available to most of us. We've all been present, and we've all been not present. So the idea that presence is some lifelong goal and that you eventually might get there really bothers me, because I think it really puts people off and it makes it seem inaccessible, and it's for wealthy people or people who go to yoga retreats, or, you know, people have all these misconceptions about it. And I'm not saying yoga retreats are bad, but it's available to everybody. And the beauty in it is that when people are able to be present, to be there, to bring their best selves forward and really, really be comfortable doing that, people immediately trust them because they're being consistent, they're being harmonious, their verbals and their nonverbals synchronize, and research shows that very clearly. When people are lying, when they're being inauthentic, they look disharmonious, they're not synchronized, they're discombobulated, and that's actually the best cue that somebody is lying. So when people are being authentic and present, they're harmonious and fluid. And that tells other people that they can be comfortable and be trusting enough to be themselves as well. So that's how presence really begets presence. It's through this building of trust, and that becomes this conduit of influence. So it's kind of incredible. I mean, it seems sort of selfish, but the funny thing is that when people are being present, they're actually less self-focused. They're able to focus on the other because they know who they are, and that allows the other to trust them. So presence really allows for trust to build. So I know we don't have a lot of time, but I'd love to talk to Adrianne again.
Sure.
And I'm going to read a little bit from the section on feelings of being an imposter, which I found after giving the TED Talk was hugely widespread. And then when I started looking at that research more clearly, I found that 80% of people that felt like an imposter, actually the ones who say they haven't, I'm a little skeptical about. But also men feeling imposters just as often as women do. And so I want to talk a little bit about about one of the people that I interviewed who has talked publicly about feeling like an imposter, and that's the writer Neil Gaiman, who I know is also a friend of this community. And Neil is phenomenally accomplished. You know, he's won many literary awards and medals. He's pretty much always on the New York Times bestseller list. He's a phenomenal writer. And he said he always felt that somebody was going to come to his door in the morning with a clipboard and a cheap suit and say, "Are you Neil Gaiman?" And he would say, "Yes, I am." He said, "Do you write books and people pay you for them?" "Yes, I do." He said, "Well, we're on to you. And now it's time to get a real job." So he always felt that somebody was going to come and say, no, it doesn't work this way. You're a phony, and we're taking your credentials away. And he said at that point, my stomach would sink, and I would go out, get a cheap suit, and start applying for real jobs. And so I talked to him a lot about this, and I asked him, can we ever break up with our imposter selves? And I want to start with a quote from somebody who wrote to me. A man who said, "I've spent the better part of my life convinced that I don't belong and am lucky or a fraud. Not once did it ever occur to me that other people felt that way." Chris, a successful 40-year-old executive. In 2011, the musician and author Amanda Palmer, who's also Neil Gaiman's wife, gave a commencement speech at the New England Institute of Art in Brookline. Neil said, she talked about the fraud police, and how she was scared that the fraud police would come along. And she asked people to put up their hands if they also worried about the fraud police. And I looked around at all these hands up, maybe 1,000, and I went, oh my God, it's everybody. And so I said to him, all right, so it's everybody, so what do you do about it? Given that everybody seems to feel it, is there hope that any of us can entirely escape the clutches of our imposter fears? Neil said yes, he remembers the point at which he stopped having the fantasy of the man with the clipboard knocking on his door. Was it when he won the Newbery Medal, I asked, or any of the other honors that had been bestowed upon him? No, he said, and he told me this. My friend Gene Wolfe actually really helped me with this. I was writing a book called American Gods, and it was a big imposter syndrome book because I wanted to write this giant book about America, but I'm English. And I wanted to talk about all these, just gods and religions and ways of seeing the world. But I finished American God, and it took me about 18 months of writing, and I was very pleased with myself. And I ran into Gene, and I said, and bear in mind, this is like my third or fourth novel. I finished the first draft of my book, American Gods, and I think I finally figured out how to write a novel. And Gene looked at me with infinite pity and wisdom in his eyes. And he said, you never figure out how to write a novel. You just learn how to write the novel that you're on. Maybe that's a critical truth about imposterism. Most of us will probably never completely shed our fears of being fraudulent. We'll just work them out as they come, one by one. Just as I can't promise that learning about presence will give you a Zen master's existence in the eternal now, I can't say that you will soon shed all your imposter anxieties forever. New situations may stoke old fears. Future sensations of inadequacy might reawaken long-forgotten insecurities. But the more we're aware of our anxieties, the more we communicate about them, and the smarter we are about how they operate, the easier it will be to shrug off the next time they pop up. It's a game of whack-a-mole that we can win. So I'm going to ask you about this experience that you had, because it is about new experiences sort of stoking old fears. And as I talked about, it's about sort of your identity changing. With my head injury, I felt like I was a different person. And for you as a professional dancer, certainly you had a similar experience.
Yes. yes, certainly. And I love the game Whack-A-Mole, by the way, so I love that you referenced that. And I am also afraid of the frog priest. So I mean, we all are. We've read that. Raised my hand as well. And, you know, having, you know, this traumatic injury that comes onto you and completely changes you as a person, as your brain, as your identity, as the way you hold yourself, as your posture, all of that. You have to find a new normal, as I kept being told, and I was like, I don't want a new normal, I want to be my old self. You know, we talk a lot about this in the book, right? And so I was also afraid of the broad police coming by and being like, you're not your old self anymore. And so it was very difficult for me. So when I read that excerpt from the book, the one you just read, I had that aha moment where I stopped and was like, this is why we're such good friends. I was thinking, you know, I can so relate to this as a dancer. At the peak of my career, I had lost my ability to even get out of bed, and my largest accomplishment of the day was just moving from the bed to the wheelchair, to the toilet seat, to the wheelchair, to the bed, and that was it. And that was a huge accomplishment for me, and that is a huge accomplishment for people, and I applaud that. But for me, I was completely demoralized, felt not like myself, and it was extraordinarily difficult. And I felt like I wasn't a dancer anymore. People would ask me, they're like, you're a dancer. And I'm like, but I can call myself that. But the whole identity changes.
Was there a turning point for you, or was it incremental?
You know, the faking it till you become it, I was on a whole lot of Vicodin, and I told the world that I was going to dance again. And, that was part of it. I had never broken a bone or done any drugs or done any of that, so the whole, I had no idea what I was really saying. As I was being poked in the back, like, you're not a runner, you don't have a leg. But I, you know, believed that I would. It wasn't a lie, I say it, I was on Vicodin, which I was, but at the time that I said it, I didn't think that I would, but I knew I wanted to. And so I set that intentional goal, and I thought to myself, I have no idea if that's even possible, but I'm convinced that someone out there thinks it is, or hopes that it is, or is watching and said I did this to
them. The idea of a concrete long-term goal, I talk a lot about this in the book, that it's a mistake, that New Year's resolutions are disastrous, because they're too far, they're too distant, they're too big, they're abstract, and there are a million little steps in between where we can fail.
And those, sorry to interrupt, but those million little steps in between where we feel like we can fail are debilitating, you know,
exactly.
For that reason that we don't set those New Year's resolutions.
There are a million opportunities for you to quit.
Absolutely.
But I like what you said about you didn't really know if you could do it, but
yeah.
You knew you wanted to do it.
Yes.
And that was enough to make you do the next thing.
Yes.
Like one more thing, one more day.
One more thing, one more day, and when I completely wanted to give up on myself, people in Boston would be like, hey, that again. And then that would help you kind of get back up on it, right? But then, you know, it's learning to celebrate the little things that you talk a lot about.
Self-nudges. Yeah.
Self-nudges, yeah. And just doing that along the way that helps you get there and not think about that giant big goal.
So one of the other things that you and I have talked about a lot is that trauma affects the body in many ways. And obviously, physically, it affects the body in very direct, measurable ways. But post-traumatic stress is very much about the body. People feel often when they have post-traumatic stress that their body has betrayed them, that their body did not protect them from running, that it didn't do what it was supposed to do when it should have. You know, women who are survivors of sexual assault, people who are survivors of all kinds of physical assault, this is the same kind of thing. My body gave up on me. And also, we begin to shrink and lose our sense of pride. And so the body-mind connection, one of the things I learned through the work that I've done, and I know that you know about my power posing and the Wonder Woman poses and all that, and that's great, but there's so much more to this, right? The trauma, to me, post-traumatic stress is the ultimate state of powerlessness. It's the feeling that your body's given up on you, your mind has given up on you, you've lost your sense of identity, and your body, your mind, is not trusting itself. So to talk yourself out of post-traumatic stress is a trap, because you don't believe yourself. Like, why would you believe yourself when you don't trust yourself?
Like, you don't trust your brain. You're like, my brain's injured, and so I shouldn't listen to it, but I really need to do this thing.
But I can't do it,
because it's just,
So, again, back to Stuart's law and not working, but so part of why, what's been really interesting about the research I looked at is that body-mind work, and this is not just sort of on the fringes, in the mainstream, is now seen as one of the best ways to help people recover from post-traumatic stress, because it skips that mind-mind part, that self-doubt. The body is telling the mind that it's proud and powerful and confident, and so it's been enormously effective for veterans with post-traumatic stress, for example. And Adrianne and I have talked a lot about how this has worked sort of in her life, and I'd love for you to speak about that a little bit, especially being a dancer.
Yes.
And there's so many different connections there.
Yeah, so more of the body or the breathing or both?
Whichever you
want. Okay, so.
Because the breathing, the work on breathing is fascinating, and the effect that breathing has on the vagus nerve, and telling your nervous system you're not in a fight or flight response situation. You don't have to flee, there's no predator chasing you. Although
it's hard to believe that, right? when you're having the PTS, correct?
That's right.
Yeah, but to answer your question, with ballroom, obviously we talk about in ballet as well, we talk about posture all the time. And as a dance teacher, I still teach on occasion, and as a dance teacher, I know and have seen it hundreds of times that there's no greater joy than seeing a man or a woman walk into a dance lesson and walk out standing just a little bit taller because of their confidence and because that they feel this inner confidence and this inner self-awareness and presence that they have on the dance floor or in the lesson or in life. And having that good posture can make you, as you talk about all the time, get noticed in a board meeting, get noticed in an interview, in a job interview, or any of the above. And it certainly helped with me when I became pro full-time as opposed to just doing what I needed to do to get by and to afford my dance lessons, right, before I was paid for them. It can have a great impact on who you are as socially and how you're socially accepted. It really can. And to go into the breathing thing, Amy and I have talked about this a lot. Long story, I'm happy to talk about it, but it would take all day. But I had a dream since I was like 5 or 6 years old. I had a fascination with sharks, which is very random. My parents hoped it would go away, but it didn't. And to the point where I was asking corporate Fortune 500 company managers if I could have Shark Week off. So that was my one location here. I was totally down there. So I still do that. But I was laying in the hospital bed and someone said, well, are you going to die with sharks? And you haven't done it yet. And you keep talking about it. And so little by little, I started to think about it and read a little bit more about it and be a little bit more deliberate in my decisions. And I was swimming with sharks and eating, and I was talking about this. And we were talking about breathing. And I mentioned, oh, when I was diving, I felt that it was this post-marathon. And I was diving with the sharks, and I was telling you that I've never felt more at ease, ever. And I attributed that, I think we were talking, over just the location of being lost 300 miles off the coast of anywhere. No one would find me here, right? And so the PTS was lowered, but you had mentioned it's the breathing, and I thought, oh my gosh, I do that. I do that on planes. I do that on the street. I do that. I go into what I call my diving breathing. Yeah.
So there's all this work on diving and deep sea breathing, mm-hmm. And it's totally consistent with what was learned in these post-traumatic stress interventions as well. And again, it's about the body talking to the vagus nerve and saying, you're okay. If you're breathing like this, you're okay. Mm-hmm. You're breathing slowly, you're not breathing in a panicked, shallow way, you're okay. And so it really started to make me think more about the powerful posture and how expanding also allows you to breathe more deeply like that. So there's just, I think that there's this body-mind conversation that's going on constantly, even when you're sleeping. And we can find that, you know, when people wake up in the fetal position with their upper bodies, they're more anxious than when they wake up all stretched out. You know, when people run through a finish line, they throw their arms up in the air. That's because the body-mind connection is so tight. We expand when we feel powerful, when we feel proud, when we feel confident, and when we feel safe. And when we do that, we're telling our minds that we feel that way. And so much of what I talk about in the second part of the book is how that brings us to the present, because it allows us to feel confident and powerful and also safe and calm at the same time. And when we do that, we become available to ourselves and also to other people.
Certainly, absolutely. And it makes, I certainly noticed that when we were talking about the fetal position, I certainly noticed the big change in my posture and as I recovered more and more and more, and I don't really believe in the word recovered. I think it's more recovery throughout life, as you may say the same, but that, you know, but it's, you know, as you go through it, it's, you start to expand and you start to have that posture again, and it's a pretty darn good feeling as you go.
So I want to read a little bit, one last section from the book, and then I do have some special, very fun guests. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll begin in a minute. But I about somebody who approached me after a talk that I gave and told me her story about how she's been applying this work. And I wish I could show you videos and slides, but I can't do that here, because there's some great stories that people have sent me the video of it. A woman came up to me after a talk, and she told me the story that really left me speechless and in tears. I just finished giving this talk, and a number of people were waiting to say hello, to ask questions and so on, and I noticed this young woman waiting patiently. I've become really sensitive to noticing when people need privacy. I can see an intensity in her eyes. They're letting me know they have something very personal to share, something they're not comfortable saying in front of strangers. This woman was flanked by two friends who were gently touching her shoulders, speaking softly to her, comforting and encouraging her. When she reached me, eyes brimming with tears, she at first had trouble speaking. There was quite a long silence, not an uncomfortable one, more like a moment of reorienting for both of us, preparing. She gathered herself, took a deep breath, then said, "I came here to meet you because I need you to know how you changed my life. The story she told me that night changed my life, too." It beautifully demonstrated how we connect through our bodies with our authentic best selves, unlock our personal power, and use those things to be present in the midst of our most enormous challenges, freeing others to be present as well. And it illustrated exactly how I hoped people would use this research to find in their personal power when they have very little social power or status, to channel courage and generosity, to change the course of their lives, to do well for themselves and to do good for others. I asked if she'd be willing to share her story with all of you, and she said, "There's nothing I'd like more than to do that, so other people might feel supported and inspired to do the same." So we spent the next afternoon talking, and here's Kristen's story. On a whim, I moved to South America. I got married when I was really young, got divorced when I was 30, and I felt that I couldn't move on with my life until I saw the world a little bit more. So I made the point to go there, and I found a place to live with a few other people. We called it the Tree House. It was all reclaimed wood and on stilts and in completely open air. It was simple and beautiful. She began working in a local cafe. Everything seemed fine, and it wasn't right away. But within a couple of weeks, my boss started making comments to me about my body, about my chest, and about getting better tips because of my chest. And he did that more and more. He made comments all the time, constantly. And my first reaction was disappointment, because I thought, he has two small children. He lives very close to me. It's a small town. And I had a different impression of who he was in my head. But I thought, you know, I guess this is what happens. And maybe it's not that bad. Being in a foreign country, I was scared. The sense of needing to belong can be really strong and powerful and can make you afraid. You take yourself out of your comfort zone when you move to a foreign country and try to make it. The comforts were completely stripped away. Every day, the sexual harassment escalated. So I thought, I'm tough. And so I just kept going with it. I just passed it off as he's being a jerk. But it got worse and worse and worse. I don't think I even realized it then, but I was just feeling smaller and smaller. And then one day, he just stopped calling me by my name and only referred to me as a very vulgar name that I'm not going to repeat. From that day forward, that was the only name he used to address me. I knew how wrong that was, and I hated it. But then again, you sometimes question yourself and wonder, is this a big enough deal? Which sounds ridiculous now. Shortly thereafter, a small group of her close female and male friends invited her to dinner. She said she was, quote, feeling so small and broken that I almost didn't go. But she did go. I thought I'd be so ashamed to tell my friends what I'd let happen. But then I started thinking about where I had come from, what I'd gone through, who I am at my core. And so I decided to tell them about what was happening. They were so supportive, the women and the men, and that really propelled my decision. I knew at that point that I had to say something to my boss. I had to stand up for myself and for all the other people who've experienced this, for all the people who were at risk of experiencing it in the future. I had to do it for myself and for them. My friend had shared your talk with me a few months earlier that really struck a nerve then, but I realized now that now was the time to put your message into action. I had a couple of days to think about it. I decided to go in early before a morning staff meeting. I remember being alone at the treehouse, which was rare. I put on a certain song, and I made sure I dressed up in a way that made me feel good, and then I stood in this house made of stilts. I stood up straight and tall with my hands on my hips and my shoulders back, and I stood there for more than a couple minutes because I really wanted to make it stick. When I left the house, and as I began to walk into town, I felt myself getting bigger and bigger in a way I hadn't felt in a long time. I was embodying my own higher self and thinking, I've got to bring her. I have to do this for myself first and foremost, but I also have to do this for everybody else. There was no question about whether I was going to quit, whether I was going to just ignore him or send a note telling him that I quit. I could get out of the situation in other ways, but standing up for myself was a way that elevated me to my own power. When I got there, I felt strong, and I realized that my boss wasn't as big as I thought he was. Not as big as he'd been in my mind. He seemed smaller, and I felt myself taking my power back from him. I wasn't taking his power. I was just taking back the power I allowed him to take from me. I told him that I was leaving, and I told him why. I said, you know that what you've been doing is wrong. You know because you have daughters who you love, and you would never want anyone to treat them as you were treating me. I told him that I didn't want to hurt him or his business, that I wanted him to change his behavior, to not hurt anyone else, and to be a better and bigger person. He said, you're right, I'm sorry, I don't know why I've done this. And he apologized over and over again. We talked for a good 20 minutes. I felt this incredible generosity. I felt strong, but not dominant in an alpha way. I felt strong enough to be compassionate. And I almost wish I had a tape recorder of what I said, because it wasn't me, it was divine. And I responded to Kristen, it was divine because it was exactly you. It was the very best you, the strongest, most generous you. As I said at the beginning, this book is about moments. It's about being present in the moments that most challenge us. It's also about trusting that those moments build upon themselves as we nudge ourselves forward, reinforcing our thinking, feelings, and physiology. Ultimately, those moments can change our lives. The most commonly quoted line from my TED Talk is, don't fake it till you make it, fake it till you become it. That's what this is about. Incrementally nudging yourself to become the very best version of yourself. Being present during challenging moments, It's not about fooling other people to get the things you desire and having to continue with the charade. It's about fooling yourself just a little bit until you feel more powerful, more present. And it's about keeping up that practice, even if it takes time to get there. As one young woman, Monique, wrote to me, "I'm still faking it until I become it, but faking it sure is better than avoiding it." Recall what my academic crush, William James, told us: begin to be now what you will be hereafter. With all these things dancing around in my head, I was reminded of a legendary choreographer and dancer I was to know, who said, "To dance is to be out of yourself, larger, more beautiful, more powerful. This is power, it is glory on earth, and it is yours for the taking. Dance your way to presence. Seize the large, beautiful, powerful parts of yourself, the ones you love and believe. They are indeed yours for the taking." So now I'd like to introduce two surprise guests.
Talk.
So we were really excited to be invited to this conference called PopTech 5 years ago, you think? And I was flipping through the program and I was reading all the little blurbs and I thought, the rest of this stuff is okay, it's, you know, kind of sciencey, technology, artsy, but Amy Cuddy's talk, that looks cool. I'm definitely go to that one, I'm definitely going to meet her. And we were in a room, I think Reggie Watts was there. Does anyone know Reggie Watts is an incredible comedian?
He's everywhere.
Look him up. and Amy, I walked up and I said, "Amy, my name is Suz. I'm playing here. I can't wait to see your talk." And she said, "You're from David Wax Museum, I'm a fan of yours.
That's true.
And it's true, we've stayed in touch ever since. And we were here in Boston this weekend to open for a band called Guster. We played at the House of Blues two nights this weekend. And I got a Facebook message saying Amy would be here, you all would be here. And we said, can we come to your event? And she said, of course, would you play at my event? And we said, of course. So here we are. I also wanted to mention that we have been practicing power poses before our shows and even gotten our audiences to pose powerfully during shows. And it's wonderful. It really helps. And we've both been fated to be musicians. We didn't study music. This is just a wonderful act. We have to continue. We now travel with a 2-year-old daughter, so she's, whether she likes it or not, part of the act as well. But thank you so much for being here tonight. What a wonderful thing to be part of. I have presents. I'm only halfway through, Amy, because we've been on tour for 4 months. But it's been very meaningful to me as a female performer. So we wanted to play 2 more songs for you.
I've never lived in LA, but I've always wanted to. I've never lived in LA, but I've always wanted to. me bone to see the street I might live on. I Google mapped it, there I said it. Corner stores are Ayurvedic. Just past the dog salon, a gated fence with cameras on to keep us from the wolves behind. Soul is a guest in the body, you gotta treat it right. You gotta treat it right. Soul is a guest in the body. Don't kick it out too early. You cannot stay behind.